Okay, sweet.
The photographer in me.
Okay, sweet, because I just hit record, and then I said record to the cloud, and now it's like, there's like a little thing up in the left-hand side that says recording. So I'm like, okay, okay. Okay, sick, cool. Well, I see Mark now and Jordan, they just showed up. What's up, Mark? And yeah, everything seems great. So yeah, we'll just punch it here once we get Sam, and we've got like 3 more minutes till 2. One for you guys, but yeah. Cool, all right, thanks so much. Okay, see ya.
Stop.
Hey, how are you guys?
Good. Enjoying our second rest day in rifle.
Ooh. Oh, nice. Dude, where are you guys?
We're at a friend's house, Lucas Hill, in town, on his back porch.
Oh, cool. In Glenwood?
Rifle.
Oh, dang. He lives in Rifle.
Yeah, rifle proper. Yeah.
That's serious.
Yeah, and his wife's a masseuse, too, so that doesn't hurt.
Dude.
That's awesome.
That's unfair. That's pretty sweet.
She'll charge us, but still, what the heck?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah, why not? Yeah.
Not too bad.
Okay. Yeah. Sick. I was gonna say, you know what's some really good beta that we found when we were there a couple weeks ago was Elk Creek Campground. It's like it's on your way out if you're heading towards Newcastle. It seems like you guys are dialed, but if they ever fall through or whatever, it's just called Elk Creek Campground, but you can do laundry there. They have showers for like, I think it's $2 or $3. And they also have like ripper internet, and it's really close to the canyon. Like it's right. Probably even closer than the actual town of Rifle. So it's just a good
heading off. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah. Like if you drive from Glenwood and you go through Newcastle and go that way, then you'll see it. It's right on your right hand side.
We're in the proper campground right now, but that might be a nice alternative once our 14-day limit is up, you know?
Yeah, I mean that you can camp there, or like we were just going there on rest days just to like we would get ice, like
oh,
get
yeah, sure.
All the other better. Stuff. Yeah.
Okay.
Chill.
Good beta. Hey, I have a question for you.
Yeah, what's up?
Best 12C and 12D in rifle. I'm trying to figure out where to start.
12C and 12D?
Yeah.
My
thought was
hang 'em higher is pretty damn good.
Okay, that's what I thought, but I'm still asking.
That one's cool.
I've heard Hand Me the Canteen Boy, but I've also heard that it's harder.
It's okay. It's just kind of short and turdy compared to some other options, you know?
Yeah.
Sam, did you grow a beard in the last 2 days?
I just haven't shaved in a while.
Okay. It was just dark there.
Can you guys hear me?
This is my It's a little quiet.
Not super well. Hair and makeup.
Oh, I get hair and makeup hasn't arrived yet.
So yeah, Sam, try talking again. Can't hear you at all now. You guys getting anything?
No.
No.
Okay.
No, Sam.
Oh, nice shirt, Sam. I gave him that shirt.
All right. Is that better?
Oh my God! Yeah, loud and clear.
Okay. I'm using the laptop audio. Like the microphone on the laptop, wherever that is.
Oh, sweet. Yeah, okay. No, that sounds great. Okay, we're pretty much on time right now. I'll punch it here in a second. Just let you guys know, basically, I'm gonna introduce you guys, welcome you, and then I'm pretty much just gonna punch it right into some questions. And I think like the best case scenario is we keep it pretty informal. Like it doesn't have to be perfect. Like some joking, and if we go off topic or whatever, it's totally fine. I'll reel everybody back in if we need to. But no, I think people are just psyched that we've got a bunch of questions for you guys. So I think between this and any questions that we get live, like we'll be set for a little while. So yeah.
Fun.
Do you have like a light screen behind you or a light shade? Because your background is really bright.
Oh, really?
And so your face is dark.
Let me try moving over here.
Mark, I've never been so proud.
I was thinking, ew, dang.
Is that better?
Filmmakers here are 1,000 times better.
When I talk, I'll go into the light.
Just an inch, you'll be looking like you're wearing that lampshade as a hat.
They call that what do they call that? They call that a tangent.
That's my art direction.
You're totally pro now.
All right, sick. Okay, we're gonna go live here. Okay, everyone. Welcome, world. My name is Jonathan Siegrist. We are now live here with many of the people involved with the film As Free As Can Be, which you guys have been checking out on the Arc'teryx site since Monday. And it's kind of blasted all over the internet now. I actually watched it on Rock and Ice earlier, and people are psyched and picking up on it. So we've got a number of the people involved, like I said, with us today. Actually don't know how people are viewing this, but from on my screen on the top left, I have Mary Jeans. She edited the film, and she's a total badass here, residing in Colorado at the time. Is that correct?
Yeah, in Boulder with you.
Yeah, I'm in Boulder right now too with my parents. So great to have you, Mary. Thanks for being here. Down in my corner here, I've also got Jordan and Mark, who are the stars of the film. If you guys watched the movie, then you obviously know a little bit more about these guys. These guys are actually in Rifle at the moment, quite a different place from Yosemite, but it's still rock climbing, right? More or less.
Yeah. Well, still having fun.
And then we also have Sam Crosley, who is the producer and director of the film. So we're going to have a bunch of different, we've got a ton of questions lined up for you guys. Actually, Sam, where are you at right now? You're outside. You're having more fun than most of us. What's going on over there?
I'm on a shoot outside of a house right now in Salt Lake City.
Oh, right on. Nice. Yeah. Very cool. Are you getting some of this like cooler temperatures that we've got going on in Colorado right now? Like today was the only day that's been like reasonable to be outside in the last 2 weeks.
Well, I was in Boulder last night, and it was like raining yesterday, and it was really nice. And same here. I think that the heat wave was like 2 weeks ago. And then, of course, all the smoke from the wildfires seemed to have died down. So it doesn't feel as apocalyptic.
Yeah, I agree. It feels so much nicer.
It's nice in the shade here.
Nice. So, as I was saying, basically all week we had it open for questions as people were checking out the film, viewing it for the first time. And then what's also possible, anyone who's attending now can jump on the chat and ask questions at any time. I'm sure there'll be a bunch of stuff flowing in, so we unfortunately won't be able to get to everybody's questions, but we've got a bunch to talk about here, and these guys are all awesome and ready to chat and share with you. So, let's freaking just get right into it. As Free As Can Be, what I wanted to start with is basically just to talk to you guys about like how this came to be. I mean, we learned in the film how Mark and Jordan first came to meet one another and spend these years climbing together. But I'd love to hear, I know Sam, you spend a ton of time in the Valley and you've worked with basically all the heavy hitters in the Valley. Was this something of your idea to pull this film together, or was it an idea like, obviously they would have had this goal with or without the film, but I'm kind of just curious on how the four of you guys and the film itself all like came to be and how everything came together.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think to start off, it started off with Jordan and I being in the Valley at the same time. I met him and I was working on Free Solo, and we ended up working together on Free Solo to get an angle like halfway up Middle Cathedral to shoot El Cap for assets for a VR video so they could get the textures right. And like when I met Jordan, first off, he was like really cool and just a nice guy. And like then when I worked with him, he was super professional. Like he was on time. He got everything like as a rigger, what he was doing, like I just could focus on camera work, which is really nice. And so getting to know him was really fun because I wasn't stressed about any of the work. And that's really something that's important when you try to make a film about someone one day, is that they're easy to work with and that they're professional, right? Because you don't want to make a film about someone that maybe is kind of into rock climbing. And like from the get-go, Jordan was definitely into rock climbing. But more than that, he had a great personality. He was fun to be with. And also he was a climbing history nerd unlike anyone I had ever met. And so I thought that was really interesting. And so I just hung out with him as a friend and took photos of him as he was doing cool stuff in the valley. And, you know, he was kind of like doing bigger and bigger things and climbing with people like Alex Honnold. And so I realized, like, you know, this isn't someone that I'm just interested in, but a lot of people seem to be interested in him. And so as I was shooting him, photographing him, he ended up hanging out with Mark. And then I ended up hanging out with Mark and Jordan, photographing them. And I was like, okay, wait, like photographs aren't doing this partnership justice. And so that was the inception of the idea. It's like, I need to film these people. And then everything kind of morphed from there.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I mean, clearly from the film, but also from what time I've spent with Jordan and a little bit of time I've spent with Mark, like the dynamic is something that, like you said, you're totally right. You can't capture that with photos, you know, like that's like a film piece. So, so it's clearly like a good zone to go into. Mary, then how did Mary come online and how did your editing skills get thrown into the mix?
Well, Sam and I worked on a film last year called Far Away, which was shot in China. And that was my first time editing a documentary, and Sam kind of just let me run with it. So when it came down to Sam having another film to make, we just kind of made a good team. So we teamed up together again. And this was definitely a very different story than the previous one. The previous one was like, okay, they go and do these things, you follow them as they do it. And this one, as you saw in the movie, it had a really different structure. So it was interesting kind of diving into like having a little more fun with structure and story. So that was fun.
Yeah, that's awesome. Did you guys, Sam and Mary, did you guys work together as far as like building the story, or was it all kind of like, cause I know that a lot of times in post things, you know, there's decision-making that really helps to narrate the story and like really like, you know, take you down a certain path. And I know that interestingly, and this is quite unusual, not that unusual, but like Mary has never even actually met Jordan and Mark. You spent dozens of hours. Yeah. You spent 100 hours probably staring at their faces and hearing them speak and stuff like that. But yeah, tell me a little bit about like how, I mean, obviously there was a story and journalistically you were there, Sam, and some others were there filming and capturing that. But how do you guys work together as like a director and, you know, director of photography and then also an editor to like make the story what it is?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I don't think a lot of people understand how much power the editor of a documentary has. And that's why I specifically trust Mary to do what she does, because she's done it so well before. And on this film, she took what she did even further. And so what you're seeing with the film is not just what I shot, but it's really both of our perspectives in the editing room, like talking about everything at such a minute detail that comes across, hopefully, in like a way where you don't even notice. You just kind of flow through a story. And so this, the kind of like the delegation of duties was interesting with this film, because while working on Far Away, we could work next to each other. And so like I would have a set of drives, Mary would have a set of drives, and we would be working in the same room. And I would try to like help edit a scene in the way that I thought it might come together. And she'd kind of take that scene and edit it in a much better way. That is just like using all of her ways to make it look good. But like this was a little bit different because we got together in January and we did a lot of organizational editing and just watching through everything that we shot. At the same time, we were trying to figure out, you know, how to present Jordan and Mark both as characters individually, but also have their partnership be a character, and then also how to tell the story, because we had this issue of two ascents. And so like when one person summits, that's kind of the climax of the film. So like we had to figure out an interesting story structure where you don't necessarily follow along on one ascent and then end. And so that whole process was just a lot of back and forth. Mary, you can talk about this, of course, in a little bit. I just want to say, like, during COVID, it was kind of interesting working to, remotely with an editor, and I'm sure you have a lot to say about this, working remotely with the director. Like, we were sending a lot of clips back and forth via Vimeo or Frame.io, which is like a review process application, but also like just sending the Premiere project, which is the editing software. We would just send it back and forth, and like we'd spend a week focusing on one thing and Mary'd focus on another thing, and then we'd talk about it. And so it was interesting trying to create a totally different workflow than normal. And we both edited scenes, and then everything kind of came together at the end. So Mary, I'm interested in what you have to say too.
Well, we were talking about this with friends the other night. Something that's interesting is like what you go into it thinking you're gonna get out of it, you end up getting something totally different out of it. So when Sam showed up in January and we talked about story, we like broke down the story. We spent weeks looking at this footage, like not even touching it, just watching it. And we had like this solid idea of, oh, this is gonna be the story. We're gonna go into all of these things. And initially it was supposed to be like a story more about Jordan. And as it ended up developing, as we went through it, more and more kept getting chopped because we realized it wasn't totally Jordan's story. It ended up being like, it ended up being Mark's story more and then the partnership story. And so it's interesting to see how a story comes in and it completely changes from the beginning and how you have to just be okay with, and a nice film quote is killing your babies, cutting out the things that you really love, but just don't serve the story. And so the film, when we first edited it together, it was like over an hour long and we had to go through and chop out so much.
Oh, yeah.
It's just interesting seeing how the story changes quite quickly.
Sam, can I add something? I'm just remembering to kind of the inception of the film idea. And, you know, when Mark and I, Jonathan, you remember when we, Mark and I were at the start of our trip, over 2 years ago, basically, or a year and a half, maybe, we were at your event in Vegas. And shortly after that, Sam came out and shot some photos. Because I've worked with Sam more than anyone at this point, you know. We're both the same age and we're kind of like getting into the industry at the same time. And so we've been able to like help each other out by shooting photos together. And so, yeah, he came out to Vegas just to shoot photos. And then we went to Zion and he shot photos on Moonlight Buttress. And then I think shortly after that, he had the idea. He was like, hey, like, we should make a film about this. But that idea really didn't hold or take traction until months later. It was kind of an idea floating around and, you know, Sam, but basically Mark and I traveled all year and kind of started filming ourselves. You know, I was filming a lot on my phone for Instagram, and then Sam educated me to flip it horizontally so that it could be used more, you know, in a professional way. And then I even bought a camera last summer and was starting to film. But there was a ton of stuff that was recorded that wasn't in the film because we didn't actually get the project approved or the film process or the film permits to shoot in Yosemite until, you know, the fall season when we actually climbed the route. But you know, there was a whole lot going into it before then, but it took a while for it to actually take hold, I think.
Yeah, that's a good point. Originally, you're going to do two separate routes in the spring.
Right,
which actually it was the winter apocalypse, right? Or...
Right, because the original goal was for me to support Mark on the Freerider, and then for me to climb Golden Gate, which was my project from the season prior before I had met him. And then, you know, we did Golden Gate in the spring. Mark wasn't able to do the Freerider that season. And then, yeah, so we had to come back. And that's when I shifted my goal from, you know, I was like, well, if I'm spending all this time with Mark on the Freerider, might as well like try and do it for myself as well, you know? Yeah. And so that's kind of where our goals changed in the fall.
Yeah, I actually really liked, I noticed that there were a few shots in there that were clearly like on an iPhone, you know, that were like vertical like this. But totally. It's funny because all it takes is 2 second clip. Like, you know, there's this clip in the middle where Jordan, you're filming Mark as he like comes up to an anchor or something, and you're just, and it actually, are you guys on Velvet Tongue?
No. Oh, it's that was like the lizard tower in the Fisher Towers in Moab or something.
Oh, was it? God, it really looked like Red Rock.
No. The very first one where he's like, oh, it's hard. Yeah.
Yeah. That's all it's like a 1 second clip and it's just like, yeah. How you doing, Mark? And he's like, God, this is hard. And then just like carries on. I'm like, that's, you know, that's where like, it's okay to have iPhone vertical footage is if it's going to be 1 second and it's funny. And then, you know, you get out of there.
Well, the other thing is when Mark and I started climbing together, and I'd like you to touch on this a little bit, is I was very concerned that that other people might not, you know, understand why I'm climbing with this old guy. A lot of people my age anyways who didn't know who Mark was quite yet were kind of like, what are you doing climbing with this old guy? Like, who is this? You know? And I was like, man, I feel like this is a cool story. This is something I'm like really passionate about and having fun with and you know, and believe in. But it took a while for our partnership to gain traction. But I was filming and posting stuff on Instagram early on. And I think maybe about a month into our spring trip, it really took hold and people really started to enjoy. And so it only encouraged me to film these little clips, particularly about Mark, more and more, because people just found him to be very entertaining. And I enjoyed
it. You know, I would have to agree.
And enjoyed showcasing our road trip in that way. So yeah, I have a ton of Instagram photo or videos that I sent their way that I'm really happy made it into the film, because I thought that was fun.
Yeah. And in some ways you're probably proving to the world, like, this guy's a freaking badass. Like, I know you guys don't know you might not know who he is, but he's like, check this out. He's a badass. Like, this is a legit partnership. It's not like I'm guiding this dude everywhere, you know?
That's totally how I felt at first. I was like, no, I'm going to show Mark and prove to everybody that he's rad. And it didn't take too long. But then also, it's a little weird with the different generation, you know, because I have a lot of older climbing friends and a lot of them don't feel very fondly about modern climbing media or social media or, you know, always having your phone out and kind of thing. And Mark was a little bit, I don't know, not into it at first, but yeah. It obviously grew on you.
I didn't know, you know, I hadn't seen this kind of thing. I didn't know what Jordan's, what his focus, what his image that he was portraying on this Instagram thing. And it wasn't too long that I sat him down and I said, hey, I don't have this on my computer. I'm not watching it. I'm not really aware of it. But if I'm involved, it's going to be fun. You know, we are not like badass. We are not, you know, killing the world. We are climbing and we are having fun. And, yeah. And I said, we want to encompass everyone. We don't want to just say, you know, we climbed Moonlight Buttress or we climbed this, we're badass. It's like, no, we're having fun doing this stuff.
Yeah. So I have to say, Mark, so my father's been a role model of mine for a long time. He's 70 years old, still climbs a ton, you know, yeah. Climbs in the last, he climbed his hardest route just 3 years ago at 67. And so I've seen his progression and, you know, to be quite honest, he's climbed his hardest routes in the last 5 or 10 years. And something that is quintessential to his character is how light he keeps everything.
Yeah.
It's not as though he's very goal oriented and it's not as though climbing is not important to him, but you very much reminded me of him while I was watching the film, because the moments are always strewn together with something light, like a song or, you know, like a joke or just something to keep the mood kind of like a little bit more airy and easy to be in. Is that like could it be that that's like a part of the success story to having a lifelong climbing career, or is that just something about your personality in particular, or what is that?
I definitely used to be serious.
Yeah, I was definitely a punk, you know, when I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to be good. I took climbing way serious. It defined me. You know, I mean, I wasn't a dick, but I definitely wanted to be a better climber than you. I wanted to do it a little bit faster. I wanted to do it a little bit more relaxed. I mean, I wasn't going to put you down to do it, mm-hmm. but over the, you know, I've done stuff. I've done a ton of stuff. So I have nothing to prove. I have no one to impress, mm-hmm. you know? So
So I can just be the happiest guy around. You know, I fail off a route. Sure, I don't like to fail off a route, but it isn't going to ruin my day.
Yeah.
I just, it's like I've done it, and I don't need any more. And so everything I get is a gift. And so I just make it a point to enjoy everything.
Well, I mean, in the end, that's the most badass attitude you could possibly have.
And
a lot of people that might be more guided by competitiveness or, you know, feeling like maybe the attitude that you had as you were younger, you know, ultimately that could lead to burnout, or it could be detrimental to their climbing more so than just being light and just freaking going with it and having a good time as much as you can.
If on your tombstone you want "I climbed 515B, that's going to be pretty sad.
Yeah, I know, exactly. I couldn't agree more.
That's not who you are. I want mine to be, you know, he had fun, you know, he was helpful, and he was psyched.
Yeah, sang well, songs.
I think it's interesting, John. You know, a lot of people might expect, even if they climb their whole life, they expect that they're going to have the best year of their lives climbing-wise in their 20s or 30s. When, you know, like you just said, your dad climbed his hardest route at 67, and Mark just had the best year of his life at 64. And so having a more like longevity attitude towards climbing, I think, I don't know, yeah, can pay off further on down the road. And so I'm sure you've learned from your dad in that way. And Mark has very much tried to, you know, adjust my mindset, because I have a tendency to be, you know, pretty serious in myself and, you know, try and just like relax and be a little more easygoing with it all sometimes.
Totally.
I tell Jordan the story that when, you know, 20 years from now, when he comes and visits me in the old folks home, we're not going to be talking about, remember how we did, you know, this route and how what it was rated. We're going to talk about when we went climbing and we had such a great time and it was such a beautiful day. Yeah. We're not going to remember the name of the route. We're not going to remember the rating of the route, but that thing there, you know, there we were together. Yeah, do you remember that? That was so beautiful. We had such a good time that day.
Totally.
That's what you're going to go down with.
Yeah, the stories are always more memorable than a number or, you know, yeah, totally. Well, listen, you guys, we got like a ton of questions from people all across the country and world that I want to, there's no way we'll get to all of them, but I'd like to try and get to some of them. Some will be quick to answer. Some will be a little slower, but let's just fully get into it. So, okay. So the first one, and actually I had this question too, but this comes from Gary Nordenstam. He said, what drove your individual decisions to do the Teflon corner versus the boulder problem? Like, you know, basically when you're climbing Freerider, you're climbing one route, but then there's this spot where you can choose between two cruxes that either way you go, it's going to be the hardest part of the route. But you have a Teflon corner, short section of super slippery dihedral climbing, or you have the boulder problem, which is like a short section of kind of face climbing on bad holds and like balancey, powerful movement. So what made like you, Mark, choose the Teflon corner and you, Jordan, choose the boulder problem?
Which, hang on, first of all, how crazy is that? How many multi-pitch routes are there where the hardest part, there's like two options? I can't think of another.
Not to mention there's two options that are really similar in difficulty, just polar opposite styles too, you know. Yeah. Like that's totally psycho, but anyways,
what about the schnoz and the changing corners on the nose?
Yeah, now you're getting specific, Sam. Not many people know about that.
Okay, fine.
Know that you shot it. Why'd you do the Teflon, Mark?
To me, the boulder problem seemed more like a boulder problem, and I'm not a boulderer. It also seemed a little bit more like a taller person's climb. Mm. I've dangled around there before, and I've made believe I was doing the kick, and I came nowhere near it.
Yeah.
The corner, you know, aside from all evidence to the contrary in the movie, I could actually stem pretty well.
Right.
You know, it seemed more of like, oh yeah, that's more of a
you know, trad climbing thing. And it would seem that, yeah, I could probably do that. And so I just, yeah, that was just sort of the way it seemed for me, that it was just going to be more obvious, more up my wheelhouse kind of thing.
Totally. Yeah.
You know, and if you compare the two styles, you know, stemming a slick blank corner is much more old school than, you know, yeah, crimping a V7 face, yeah, you know.
Totally.
Some dynamic, you know, a dynamic kick or a potential dyno. And so, yeah, it's kind of, I think it's kind of interesting how that might parallel, you know, the generational difference between our climbing. But the first time I climbed the Freerider 4 years ago, I hadn't climbed 513 at the time. And so I looked at the boulder problem and I was like, no way, you know, I can't climb V8 or V7 or whatever it is. And so I did the Teflon originally, but it's not that enjoyable. You know, I really like stemming corners, and there are some amazing stemming corners on OCAP, like on the Muir, for example. But, you know, you look at the Teflon, you're just like, that's the crux pitch. You know, you think OCAP crux pitch, you think like super awesome aesthetic beauty, like
stop the head wall.
And it's, yeah, like, yeah, the Teflon corner is not that. It's,
yeah,
very much, Peter says, it's like,
yeah, you know, it's
very unpleasant compared to the rest of the route. And so honestly, after having done it once, I was just like, I don't want to do that again. And then from my standpoint, trying to do it in a day, the boulder problem, once you have it dialed, you can execute it pretty, like, you know, because you're following a sequence. Whereas the Teflon, you can fall at any point at any time, really.
Totally, yeah. I could see that.
It just didn't make sense. And yeah, then, yeah, I find the boulder problem to be way more fun now that I can actually do it.
Yeah. Okay, so this is a perfect segue. I've got another question from Oliver May. Sam, how do you navigate filming everything on the red point push? Because, like, from an athlete's perspective, it does add a little bit of stress, but more than anything, like, logistically staying out of people's way, you know, and being like a fly on the wall, pure journalistic style, that can be hard on like a sport route, let alone like, you know, filming something as big as LCAP. So how did you like manage to like kind of let these guys have their space and were you doing just tons of walking up the east ledges and rapping and all that stuff, or how did all that go for you?
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of hiking up the backside of El Cap and wrapping in. So, I mean, there's a lot that goes into filming on El Cap. It's kind of like, it's no single pitch, right? And so there's, yeah, a lot of logistics. So I'll take Jordan's ascent to explain this, because it's a little bit more interesting, because it was just in a day, well, less than a day. And so like the timing of everything has to be spot on. And so what ends up happening is we have to hire people to help out. And so what that looked like was Max Buscini woke up at like 12:30 in the morning to like document them getting up and going to El Cap. And then Max not only was documenting them on the ground, but he went up the heart lines, which on El Cap, there are some fixed lines on the Salathe. And so after shooting everything in the morning, Max went up the heart lines and continued shooting them. And so for this, the bottom section of the route, pretty much one camera guy was like tasked with covering it, which then left the rest of the route up to me. And so the obvious points to document were the boulder problem, which is halfway down El Cap. So you have to rappel 1500 feet down. It's a little bit less than that, but what that looks like is waking up also at like 2:30 in the morning, hiking up El Cap as fast as you can. And we had stashed ropes up there the previous days. And so we wouldn't have to hike up the ropes, thank God, because that's a lot of weight.
Yeah.
But we hired a rigger named Christian Black, and he helped me just completely wrap El Cap in the morning, you know, before sunrise, like wrapping into the abyss. And then he helped us jug out as well, because just like jugging out with 1500 feet of rope is nearly impossible. So just getting into position is like a lot of coordinating with other people and timing it to be right, like knowing exactly how long it's going to take to get up the east ledges and giving yourself enough time to take a break and drink water, have a snack, and then wrap in. And just like, there's the just so much that goes into it. What's that, Jordan?
All the while texting us for updates to make sure we're like, you know, where everybody's supposed to be.
Yeah, exactly. Because I have to get into position early because I definitely can't be late. And so what that looked like is like me just wrapping into the boulder problem before Jordan gets there and pretty much just hanging out, waiting for him to show up. And then he did. And then the sun was arriving. So I don't know. There's so much that I could go into. I don't want to take up too much time. But that's how you film on El Cap. There's two ways. You can either hang out with the athletes, you know, going up with them, but that's kind of not ideal because of all the technical logistics with cameras, batteries, and whatnot, and food and water. So wrapping in, lots of wrapping.
Yeah, and I mean, it sounds like too. Ultimately, the very short answer is the way to do it is with a lot of help.
Yeah, a lot of help.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, those scenes where we see them waking up, you know, doing jumping jacks next to the car or whatever to get hype and then like going and climbing up the wall and you only see 1 or 2 minutes of action from the viewer's perspective. There's like somebody on the ground shooting, somebody wrapping in, somebody hiking up, somebody, you know, there's just like so many things going on so that these guys can just focus on sending and you guys can focus on getting the footage and making it all happen seamlessly, mm-hmm. best as possible.
Yeah. I mean, all that work to like make sure that you guys aren't worried about us, you know, like developing that kind of relationship is huge.
It is. Yeah, no, totally. Hey, Mary, I have a question for you. So during the editing process, was there ever a moment when you were like you're putting everything together? Again, you had never met these guys. You weren't necessarily there while it was taking place. You just got like this dump of probably 100 hours of footage to condense, you know? So that seems like a ton of footage to narrow down, but was there ever a moment when you were like, God, I just really need this thing. Like the story is perfect, but it's missing like this one tiny bit of like a scene or one of them saying something or like something to build the story or anything like that. Was there anything that you feel like you missed or that you really wanted, or did you have everything you need and it was mostly an issue of just like combing through tons of footage?
Well, it was somewhere between 60 and 80 hours of footage. So you were close.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
To go through. The fun thing about editing is that if you don't have editing a documentary in particular, if you don't have something that you need, you either have to go out and get it. So there were times where Sam would go out and he'd get extra shots that we needed. He filmed with them a few more times during the editing process just to get pickup interviews, extra lines we needed, just to really explain certain things. But you get really creative as an editor. You start looking through like, okay, well, I'm editing this scene from this day. Well, let me check 2 months past where he filmed with them a few months ago. Let me see if there's something there. It's like, here's a reaction shot. And it's not the same day or even the same place, but it fits. And totally. So there's a lot of that in the film that maybe you don't notice because you get good at kind of stitching things together and smoothing it all over with audio and music and whatever. So it just gets to a creative point where you're just kind of picking things out. So you have to really dive into the footage. Ultimately, as an editor, I have to watch every moment of footage in the film. Can't have someone else watch it and tell you what happened, because there could be just a look or a cough or some kind of weird little phrase that ends up being extremely useful down the line. And so it takes a lot of time to learn the footage. And so that's why it takes 6 months to edit a 30-minute piece sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, I think people, absolutely, I think editing is so underappreciated and people don't understand how hard it is to just turn raw, random moments into like a story, you know? So yeah, I feel you. That's a lot of time. That 60 to 80 hours is a lot of time for your favorite Netflix show, let alone like, you know, probably a bunch of random footage that you don't need to see anyways.
Yeah, it's kind of weird because I feel like I know you and Jordan, Mark and Jordan so well, and you guys have never really met me. And I'm like, oh no, they're my best buddies.
Hard work.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've got a question from Joe Tillack. Oh, I can probably answer this right away. It says, do they climb at Mesa Rim in San Diego? They look familiar. And I'm going to go ahead and say, yes, you guys do climb at Mesa Rim, San Diego.
We have.
Yeah.
I used to live down there and work there. So yeah.
Okay. Awesome. All right. So I've got another one. From Chris Barton, what's the beverage of choice for sending?
Tequila.
We're sending. I mean, really, 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 water, you know, be hydrated.
Mark doesn't drink enough water.
Yeah, I don't drink enough water.
But he drinks plenty of tequila at night.
Yeah. And it doesn't seem to have hurt so far, so I'm not going to stop.
Hey, man. I'd say whatever's got you this
for filmmaking, too.
Oh, yeah. Mary, what's the drink of choice for filmmaking? It's also tequila?
It's also tequila, yeah. Just got off a film set where it was every day.
Very nice.
Coffee in the morning, tequila at night, water during the day. That helps you send at life.
All right. That seems legit. That seems legit. Sam, do you have a... I assume you're probably as sober as possible while you're like rapping.
Yeah, no, I'm definitely, yeah, just water up there.
Okay, cool. Okay.
Gatorade.
Oh yeah, nice.
Yeah, Gatorade definitely tastes really good after an entire day hot on the wall.
Cold sports drink.
He's always bringing us good snacks when we're on the wall, so.
Nice.
He's providing morale and sustenance.
You brought the back and salsa on top when I finished the route.
Oh wow, that's service there. That's amazing.
That's the fun thing about like being a filmmaker with the athletes is like, you know, I have so much respect for what both of you guys do, right? And so like if I can help you out at the summit by just hauling up some chips and salsa, like of course I'm gonna do that. Like Alex's favorite is cookies. And, you know, it's fun to make someone happy.
Okay, so I've got a question for you, Mark. I actually celebrated a birthday yesterday. So I think in one way or another I'm an aging climber, although I still consider myself quite young. One thing that I've noticed in my climbing is that I feel better, and in a lot of ways I actually feel stronger. The main difference from now, I'm 35 now, the main difference from being in my early 20s to now is that I just need a couple more rest days than I used to. But otherwise, like, I feel better and smarter and stronger. At least I hope so. Do you have any, like, what's your experience been? I mean, you've been climbing longer than I think anyone else in this interview has been alive.
I think so.
Yeah. How has your relationship to climbing changed, your relationship with your body? Like what do you need now that you didn't need before? Or likewise, what don't you need now that you used to need before? Like how different is it, or is it different?
I definitely need to warm up. That was one thing that Jordan, I mean, the real serious, you know, you see us doing those jumping jacks and we've got, mm-hmm. 9 or 10 exercises we do. We're coming to the sport cliff. We've got one of the little portable boards. We do that.
Oh, yeah. And you'll be happy to know that even the day that Jordan and I went cragging in Bishop, without you there prompting him, he still did all of his warm-ups very nicely, one after the other. Just like, you know, all choreographed like as though I think you guys were like ready to climb the Capitan.
I've just been on my hangboard and I'll hang and I can just, you know, I can barely crimp and I'll come down and, you know, 15 seconds later I'll go back and I'll feel better. And after 3-4 sets of that, I actually feel pretty good. So it just makes real sense for me to do that warm up. I forgot.
I mean, you would think that more rest for somebody his age.
Well, and then rest. But I mean, I mean, you know, trying to keep up with him. I mean, I'm 40 years older than him. And so, you know, we're trying to be on the same schedule. But at a certain point, I go, Jordan, you need to go climb with somebody else because I'm just going to sleep all day. But it's just, I ended up with a good body. I have a good body. I can still do it, you know? I mean, I eat well. I've never eaten poorly. I don't eat junk food. I don't drink Coke, you know? I mean, probably my biggest vices are beer and tequila. But I weigh the same weight that I weighed in high school, and I'm not injured, you know? The worst thing I have right now is I've got arthritis in my thumbs, which is bumming me out.
Oh, but, and your thumbs, wow. Huh.
Yeah, yeah. I need to get taken care of. But, it, you know, so just warming up, eating well, staying active, keep your weight down.
And then more rest on occasion.
And more rest.
Yeah, and then just having that occasional day where you sleep all day.
Yeah, yeah.
That's awesome. Go ahead, Sam.
Oh, Mark, I'm interested. One thing I didn't get to include in the film is, like, there's so much history that I can dive into. Can you kind of run through quickly, like, your careers that you call of climbing? Because I think that's interesting.
Yeah. Okay, I say I have four climbing careers. My first one started in 1972 and went to about 84 or 85. You know, my career with Max, my originally going to Yosemite and, you know, doing the South A with Max and all that kind of stuff. And the 80s was the start of the whole sport climbing thing. So there was a bunch of, everything was slander and people were getting in fist fights, and I sort of felt like I had done climbing. So I just wasn't really that interested in it. I got into windsurfing, and then I ended up moving to Hood River, Oregon. Ended up getting married, ended up starting a coffee roasting company with my wife. And then in 1990, someone asked me to build them a climbing wall because I was a carpenter. And so I researched these climbing walls. You know, I called Metolius, of course, who was just a couple hours away. And I ended up getting interested in, in climbing. And so I was only 2 hours north of Smith Rock. So my second career was my sport climbing career, and I just climbed every 5'10", 5'11", 12A, 12B, 12C until I'd reached my level of incompetence. And I ended up spending a couple weeks over the course of a couple years working a 513C route. And I thought, you know what? I would rather just go throttle back on the grades and go, you know, climb the west face of El Cap. That would be way more fun. So I sort of phased out a little bit there. And then actually in 2009, some friends of mine gumbied their way up the nose in 5.5 days. And I thought, well, if they can gumby up the nose, I can gumby up the nose in 5.5 days.
Well, and then remember all the people asking you, you realize you're about climbing, you're always telling them about El Cap.
Well, that was the other thing. Whenever I would tell somebody about rock climbing, I was always telling them about climbing El Cap. And so I just went, wow, they did it, and so I can do it. So I just, that whole thing, it progressed down to doing the nose in a day, to me leading the nose in a day. And so we went there, we rented Hans Florin's house, and climbed for 3 weeks in Yosemite, and I ended up leading the nose. It was my first El Cap ascent in 30 years.
So that's your third career.
So that was the start of my third career. And then the next season, I soloed an El Cap route, and since then, I've done 20 El Cap aid routes.
Wow.
And then that was sort of fading out a little bit. I went up on the Muir, and I thought, wow, the Muir is it goes free. There's 5.11 up there. I could free climb up there. That'd be cool. And so while aiding it with this friend, I just free climbed some of the pitches. And I went, whoa, free climbing out Cap. This is neat.
Yeah.
And so that started me into what is my fourth career of trying to free climb El Cap, which meeting up with Jordan, and there you go. So I've had four climbing careers is what I call them.
That's awesome. Well, clearly climbing loves you, and you love climbing because you keep coming back.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. And I mean, here we are, we're sport climbing now, you know, I mean, which is great. You go up 60 feet, you fall off, you lower down, you pull your rope, you go back to the car, it's done deal. You know, you're not like on LCAP Spire going, oh man, you know, we gotta
get totally.
But anyway,
you happen to be at the epitome of convenience as far as sport climbing areas goes. But let me save that segue for a second. Because I do have a question for Jordan really quick in regards to history. There's a scene in the film where you were, I believe, at Donner Summit, and you had like an old Swami, and you had like some old EBs or something, and some like, you know, rigid stem friends, like some, you know, OG shit. And how was that experience? Because I've like played around with some of my dad's old like giant hexes and stuff like that, but I don't think I've ever actually done a pitch where you're literally on like, you know, 60s gear, 70s gear.
Yeah. So yeah, that scene was basically trying to capture the day that Mark and I met, you know, a little over two years ago at Donner Summit, which was at a climbing event. And our other friend, Don Welsh, he brought an old pair of EBs and his old Swami belt that he used to climb with in the, I don't know, 70s, I guess. And so I was psyched because I was hanging out with all of my old school heroes, and I got to meet Mark for the first time. But then Don brings this old school gear, and I was like, I was all over it. You know, I've always been amazed by the stuff that these guys were climbing, you know, back before sticky rubber and before leg loops and before cams and everything. And so it was a cool way for me to kind of connect with my heroes on the routes that they did the first ascent of, you know, and climb them with Mark or with Max or whoever, and then you know, be able to climb them in a Swami belt and EBs and just kind of like connect with that history and see what it was like. And I have a few thoughts. All right, so you know they're all about against hang dogging back then.
Yeah.
That's because you couldn't fucking hang in a Swami belt. You'll die and you'll breathe. Honestly, it would have been more hardcore if they hung dog, because like it takes so much core tension to like stay up there.
Did you take any whippers on the Swami?
I did, yeah.
Oh my God! Whoa.
Yeah. Well, and it's funny when you lower, you know, you have to basically like plank yourself out and like walk backwards down the wall, you know, and keep the Swami belt in, you know, the lower part of your back, and or even like hang upside down like Spider-Man, you know.
yeah
to lower yourself. And so, and honestly, it's pretty cool. Like, it doesn't make me feel nervous. I mean, you know, all of our harnesses nowadays have an advanced Swami belt just with added leg loops that distributes the weight, but you feel like a ninja climbing up there. Like, your legs are just totally like unobstructed, you know. It's pretty cool.
I can see that actually.
It sucks having to climb with like a shoulder sling, you know, with all your gear on it. I'm not used to that. I'm used to having gear loops. And then the EBs, honestly, I mean, clearly like these guys climbed a lot of hard stuff in EBs back in the day, and 40-year-old rubber EBs felt like climbing on butter. Yeah. But I climbed 512 in them. And so like, it was okay. Yeah, the shoes were not that great. Very
Yeah. I'm not surprised to hear that.
Anyways, yeah, that was a cool day for me. Because that's when I met Mark, and then I got to try out that stuff for the first time.
Yeah, no, that is awesome.
People to do if they have the chance. It's cool to connect with that history and see how far gear and ropes and, you know, harnesses and shoes have all come.
Totally, yeah. No, I geek out on the old stuff. That was a cool scene. I was like, oh yeah, I wanted to like hear more. I was hoping that you had ambitions to maybe like, you know, free climb something heinous in that, or maybe go up to Capitan.
To expand on that, there's a few, there was a scene about the Phoenix, which, you know, they talk about Mark and Max doing the second ascent of, and Mark's ascent is on the Phoenix is so iconic because, Ray did the first ascent with cams, and Mark has done the only ascent to this day on passive protection, you know, on nuts and cams. And so I did the Phoenix last season with Mark belaying me, and it was his first time being back there in 40 years, and it was totally crazy. And, you know, I had one of the hexes that he had placed on the Phoenix in 79, like on my harness. And when I topped out, he was like, oh, that's the only hex in the world to climb the Phoenix twice, you know?
Yeah.
And we talked about the idea, like Mark would like to go back and redpoint it. And I was like, I'd kind of like to go back and do it on hexes.
You know? I wanted to go back with a harness and cams and new shoes. And he was going to go do it with a waistband and EBs and hexes.
Yeah, dude.
That sounds awesome. Mark, you just got to go. Mark, go do it in like some, you know, stiff, sticky rubber shoes with brand new, like, and then you can downgrade it, man. That's all you.
Dude, because... I mean, I have so much respect for a lot of the older climbers who did totally outrageous, badass stuff, you know, that is still considered hard today. There's another scene about this route called Bliss at Donner Summit that Mark did the first ascent of, you know, same thing in a Swami belt and EBs, and he was hammering in pins, on the lead.
On the lead.
There's photos of him, and he looks like a pirate. It's crazy. and it's been retro bolted now. It's basically a sport route with a few pieces of gear. And I tried it and I like couldn't even do it at first. And, you know, and then I ended up doing it on modern gear with, you know, with modern sticky rubber. And I was like, damn, that is still proud, you know?
Totally. Like,
some of these things stand the test of time, regardless of the advancement of gears and strength and technique. They're still totally freaking hard.
Totally. Okay. So I've got a question kind of related to that. John Brower asked, do you have any tips for developing confidence leading free climbs on polished rock, especially footwork, like not in cracks? Because I have climbed a bit in El Cap, or sorry, in El Cap, in Yosemite and on El Cap. And that was probably one of the most striking takeaways, was that especially like the face climbing, like the slabby face climbing is freaking real deal, and it is very slippery, like basically all over the Capitan, you know, I mean, it's glaciated, polished, incredibly bomber granite, but for the most part, you know, your feet, trusting your feet is like a new level of confidence on El Cap than it is almost anywhere, except for maybe Rifle, where you guys are now. But do you have any suggestions for somebody like John, who's trying to improve their footwork for that type of thing?
Yeah, you just got to go climb miles, you know, just climb it. I don't know how you would, I mean, try to be standing on your feet all the time. Try to use your hands as little as possible, you know, like try to just palm the cliff. So you're actually just walking your feet up, you know, you're completely dependent on your feet. It's just, and then you just got to climb miles of it.
Yeah, and it's important to understand that in that style of climbing, like your feet are totally essential. You know, there are certain styles where, you know, your feet are important, but you can get away with just a lot of upper body strength. And granite, a lot of the times, and particularly free climbing on El Cap, is not that way. And so once you just like realize how important good footwork,
fucking hit
good
me,
footwork
man.
Is. Then, yeah, build off of that.
Okay. So now,
hippies are invading my. Oh, that's Jonathan.
We're good.
Oh, damn! What's up, guys?
What's up?
I pulled the only local climber in this goddamn city, and all the hippies are coming here.
Get out of my house, you hippies!
That was great. You can't plan on little moments like that. So this seems like as good a segue as any. You guys are now, you guys just left Tent Sleep.
Yep.
You guys are now in Rifle, Colorado. It the same way that you're a history geek, Jordan, about track climbing and climbing in Yosemite, I'm very much a history geek on sport climbing. And Rifle has a lot of it, actually. So tell me a bit about your current trip that you guys are on and what your ambitions are and what you guys are psyched to do and basically what you're doing in Rifle there.
Yeah, tell them that. Okay, so, well, we wanted to, you know, after having done all this on El Cap and doing Freerider, and having wrapped the head wall a few times, which was pretty cool. And, you know, me, it was the first time I had been to the head wall in 40 years. I thought, you know what, Jordan, you need to go free climb the South A wall.
Yeah.
So And it was like, and it'll be so cool because then I get to go back there with you and I get to climb like 10 more feet free than I did, you know, 40 years ago. I go, it'll be so freaking cool. Then I'll get to watch you free climb it.
Yeah.
So that didn't happen because we had COVID and, you know, such is life. We're scurrying to get power for the computer right now. But
that's so funny. I ran out of power too. I was on my battery outside and I was like, oh shoot, I have 2%.
Sorry. So that was our plan. And the plan did involve going to Yosemite and climbing that. But then like I said a little while ago, we had all last year was these giant missions. Get up at 2 a.m, climb some 15 pitch route, wrap down, hike out. We really wanted to just like climb 60 feet, lower off, pull the rope, and go home and drink beer.
Yeah.
So we were going, okay, yeah, we're going to go to Rifle, and we're going to go to the Fins, and we're going to go to Tent Sleep. And so the Yosemite season sort of got canceled, but we're just continuing on with the rest of it.
Yeah, and this is a good time to address. Well, also, you know, I'm trying to diversify a little bit. Jonathan, follow some of your advice. And Alex, who in the movie says that I'd be a much better climber if I didn't care about history and just trained in the gym. You know, yeah, so El Cap free climbing at a certain point, you know, becomes very bouldery and difficult, and it's important to focus on bouldering and sport climbing to improve. So yeah, Mark's been trying to climb 513 for the first time in 40 years since climbing the Phoenix, right? Actually,
No.
I
had my sport climbing career.
That's right. Never mind.
It was probably 1998. My daughter was 2 years old. Was the last time I climbed 513.
Nice.
And so I want to climb 513 again.
Yeah, awesome.
And I'm trying to climb 514 maybe.
Yeah.
But well, and then we're gonna go to the Black and get back on some adventurous routes before Yosemite in the fall, and then head our ways for the winter.
That's awesome, you guys. Well, you've totally been crushing. I've been following a bit. Jordan's let me in on a few of your successes. Mark, you're still kicking ass. You did great in Tent Sleep. I trust that you guys will kick ass in Rifle too. But yeah, that's perfect. That pretty much wraps it up. Like I said, we had a bunch more questions, but we got to as many as we could. And I love the film. I watched it several times. I wanted to be super prepared. And it was cool because I went back and watched it a couple times and I picked up on things I didn't at first. So it was totally worth it. Sam and Mary and everyone else involved, you guys totally killed it in making the film. I want to give a huge shout out to Arc'teryx for supporting the film and supporting all of us here and making something this cool happen. I wish we could all be together in person to have some beers and congratulate you guys on this awesome film. But doing a digital premiere is also pretty badass. So I see you have a beverage there already, Mark. I don't want to hold you guys back, but. But yeah, thanks again so much, you guys, Mary, Sam, Mark, Jordan, for joining in.
And just in front of everyone, I really want to thank Sam and Mary for all their hard work. Yeah.
Awesome.
And yeah, since it's hard doing a thing on Zoom and answering all these questions, Mark and I can very easily pick up with everybody, all the leftover questions with a Q&A on Instagram sometime soon. So maybe we'll do that.
Yeah, check out Jordan's Instagram page. They do Q&As and little clinics and random stuff like that all the time. So and I believe that this is being recorded, so I think that it will be put somewhere that can be accessed later, and we'll have information on that. Just follow along Arc'teryx on Instagram and yeah, you'll see all of it. But thanks everyone for tuning in. Film was awesome. It was great to chat with all you guys. Have great days. Yeah, keep kicking ass. Thanks everybody.
Thanks everyone.
Bye. 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 Bye.